Good morning,
brethren. We are now starting our gathered worship, so please take your seats and settle down. Let's prepare ourselves also, our minds, our hearts, to worship the Lord. Brethren, many of us know this old song that sings, "How sweet it is to be loved by you." You know that song, right? Well, we're not going to sing that song. Maybe in a couple's fellowship. No, so, but of course, all of us who were married perhaps, or who are engaged, planning to get married, we can say that, right? Ah, oh, how sweet it is to be loved by someone, by the person. We love that person, and that person loves us back in a special way. But if we think about that, and think about the love of Jesus, there is no comparison, right? There is no comparison. No matter how sweet is the love of a person in this life, you know, your spouse, or even a certain people who really loves you, and then that's okay. That's background music. But the love of Jesus is it's really mind-boggling, actually. It's totally different because He loves us not because we loved Him first before. It's not because we chose to love Him. It's not because we were really, wow, we fell in love with Jesus. And then, or we were, you know, somehow looking for Jesus. No, the Bible even clearly said that we were estranged in a sense from God Himself, not looking, no one is righteous, no one is looking to really even please God, to love God, to obey God, to honor God. And it's really because, simply because God in His rich mercy chose to love us, to save us from the mire of sin. Jesus loved us and He died for us even while we were yet God's enemies. That's the kind of love. Indeed, it is the sweetest thing to be loved by Jesus. And the love of Christ is the love that is, again, is beyond what we can truly comprehend. Where He came, He suffered, He died, then He rose again, and He is now in heaven as our great mediator. And in love, He continues to intercede for us so that we will be saved to the uttermost. We will be preserved indeed. That's the love of Christ. We can never be separated from His love. Every day, as Christians, as believers, it is only because Christ continues to love us that we are what we are. Everything good in life, it's because of Him. Most especially, all the spiritual blessings, all the heavenly blessings are truly ours in Christ. That is why no wonder Apostle Paul, if you read and study his writings, you will see that the passion in his heart for Christ. Because he saw himself as, who am I that you love me, Lord? He was such a hater, right, of Christ. But then Christ came and showed his love to Paul. And so he said, you know, I count everything, all of this, as loss, rubbish. I just want, for the sake of knowing Christ, yes, and I just want to pursue this. And so brethren, even this morning, as we sing these songs, prepared for our time of worship together in singing, let's meditate on that. Let's just be, let our hearts be filled with thankfulness for the love that is so undeserving from Christ. And also let our minds also continue to just remember how precious is Jesus Christ in our lives. He's the most important person in our lives as believers. Everything else is pale compared to Him. Like I said, even the most loving person in your life is nothing compared to Jesus Christ. And let us pursue Christ. Let us pursue to know Christ more and more. Please rise. Let's honor Christ together as we sing these songs together. Let's exalt the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. He truly indeed is the greatest treasure of our hearts.
time I feel that I've been caught in the mire of sin. Just the time I feel in my mind's in mourn, my worldly wear. That's when the breeze begins to blow, I know the Spirit's call. And all my worldly wanderings does melt into His love. So I want to know You more. Deep within my soul, I want to know You.
Thinking I'd be fine, never
never knew my heart was truly blind. God being rich in mercy has set my poor soul free. He showed my need of the one who saves in my depravity. Christ, the perfect Lamb of God, bled and died for me. And by faith I know I'm His eternally.
Strong desire of our hearts, Lord, to know you more and more, to pursue, Lord, the growth of knowing Christ more, to love Christ more, to trust Christ more, and to obey Him more, to glorify and exalt Christ in our lives. So as we continue today, we trust, Lord, that by your leading, the leading of the Holy Spirit in our midst, we will listen to your word with a heart that is truly wanting to honor Christ, wanting to hear Christ speak and tell us what to do in order that Christ and Christ alone will be exalted. So Lord, speak to us your word that we may know you more, that we may trust you more, that we may love you more. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We'd like to dismiss the children first to their Sunday school classes. So children, would you please stand up? Let's pray for them and pray for the teachers too. Heavenly Father, we join our hearts to bring before you these children so that even at their young age, by your sovereign will, by your grace, as they go, listen to their Sunday school classes, you will plant good seed in their hearts, seeds that will grow, seeds that will allow them to understand who you are and desire, Lord, to be reconciled with you through Christ Jesus. Thank you, dear God, because even at a young age, we believe that their minds are fertile and their hearts are fertile for the planting of your word. And we trust, dear God, that you'll do your good work upon them. Be with the teachers too. Thank you, Lord, for their sacrifice, for their love in truly teaching the children. We pray, God, that you will use them even today. We give you back all glory and honor and praise in Christ's name. Amen. So children, you may go off now to your Sunday school classes. Since this is the first Sunday of the month, we will not have our koinonia. But we will have our communion service right after the sermon. And you'd like to ask, if you're a believer, if you truly know that you are in Christ Jesus, that you join us for this communion service right after our study of the Word. Do we have first-timers here? Do we have first-timers today? Wala? Wala po? Okay, no first-timers today. So let me just get back here. Kamusta kayo? Ako? Hindi ko alam. Hindi rin alam ng doktor ko. That's actually the situation. Anyway, the Lord is truly gracious for allowing me to be ministering today. I have to thank you all, though, for your prayers and support. They are truly precious to me and my family. But I also have to thank you for your love and understanding. A shepherd of the Lord's flock should not be away from his flock and pulpit for this long. But you have been exceptionally considerate and kind. Again, maraming salamat po. After 3 hospitalizations in 5 months, and given my health situation, which the doctors are still trying to figure out, I have a greater appreciation for what it means to depend on the Lord's grace every single day. And resuming my pulpit duties in our Sunday worship gathering is certainly a big blessing and encouragement for me. I just pray that I will not have to be hospitalized and sidelined again after a number of preaching duties. But you know what James chapter 4, verses 14 to 15 says, yet you do not know what your life will be like tomorrow. You are just a vapor that appears for a little while and then vanishes away. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and also do this or that. Isn't this true? Not just for those who may be ailing, But for each one of us, no matter our situation. Now, since we've put on hold our regular pulpit series based on Matthew's gospel for over 2 months, I'm eager to pick up where we left off. Deja vu. I'm certain that most, if not all of us, know what deja vu means, even if we probably cannot spell it correctly. To be clear, the Merriam-Webster College Dictionary defines deja vu as the illusion of remembering scenes and events when experienced for the first time, or a feeling that one has seen or heard something before. And our text today may make some of us think that we are experiencing deja vu. What do I mean? Well, you have to open your Bibles with me to Matthew chapter 15. Let's read from verse 29 all the way to verse 39. Again, reading from the NASB version. Departing from there, Jesus went along by the Sea of Galilee. And having gone up on the mountain, he was sitting there. And large crowds came to him, bringing with them those who were lame, crippled, blind, mute, and many others. And they laid them down at his feet, and he healed them. So the crowd marveled as they saw the mute speaking, the crippled restored, and the lame walking, and the blind seeing. And they glorified the God of Israel. And Jesus called his disciples to him and said, I feel compassion for the people, because they have remained with me now 3 days and have nothing to eat. And I do not want to send them away hungry, for they might faint on the way. The disciples said to him, where would we get so many loaves in this desolate place to satisfy such a large crowd? And Jesus said to them, how many loaves do you have? And they said, 7, and a few small fish. And he directed the people to sit down on the ground, and he took the 7 loaves and the fish, and giving thanks, he broke them and started giving them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the people. And they all ate and were satisfied. And they picked up what was left over of the broken pieces, 7 large baskets full. And those who ate were 4,000 men, besides women and children. And sending away the crowds, Jesus got into the boat and came to the region of Magadan. To be sure, what the Lord Jesus accomplished in today's passage is familiar to most of us. We've read something similar before, right? So, is this deja vu for us? Certainly not. The passage is similar, particularly the feeding of the multitudes, yet totally distinct from some of the great works our Lord has already done. But liberal scholars have long tried to use this portion of Matthew's narrative to cast doubt on the accuracy and inspiration of Scripture. They argue that this is a duplicate or repetition of Matthew's report in chapter 14, the feeding of the 5,000. Leon Morris, however, answers this critics in his commentary and says it so well. I quote, Matthew clearly regards the two incidents as distinct. The number of people are different in the two incidents, as are the quantities of food and the amounts of leftover. The words for basket, small baskets, kofinos, in Matthew 14, large baskets, spouridos, right here in Matthew 15, are different. The people in this incident had been with Jesus 3 days, whereas in the earlier incident, they had just gone around the lake to head him off. The times appear to be different. The earlier feeding, the late feeding being when grass was green, that is in the spring, while here there is no mention of grass and the ground appears to be hard. In other words, it is late summer. End of quote. So today's text, particularly the feeding of the multitudes, is no duplicate of a previous report. There is therefore no warrant for liberal scholars to question the accuracy of Scripture. Now, this text will show us two main things. The amazing power of the Lord Jesus from verses 29 to 31 and His matchless compassion, verses 32 to 39. However, for our purpose today, we shall just cover the report regarding the Lord's amazing power displayed in this episode. But before we look into that, let's put some context. In our last venture in the study of Matthew, we saw the mercy of God spilling over to a Canaanite woman who had great faith in the Lord Jesus. She had a kind of faith that all believers should exhibit. In desperate need to find help for her demonized daughter, she went to the Lord, repentant, and turned away from her false religion and gods. She was reverent toward Jesus, yet persistent, but most of all, she was humble. For these reasons, the Lord exalted her for her exceptional faith. In our text today, we are going to see that the mercy of God continued to spill over to the Gentiles as the Lord travels to another area. So we read in verse 29, "Departing from there, Jesus went along by the Sea of Galilee, and having gone up on the mountain, He was sitting there." What? The Lord is on the move again? Why? Well, you need to realize that the Lord had been ministering among the Jews in Galilee for about a year and a half. Galilee is in the northern area of Palestine. Of course, the Lord's ministry was accompanied by many miracles, amazing signs and wonders, and unequaled teaching about the kingdom of God. But after a year and a half, it was evident that resistance to the Lord Jesus was mounting among the Jews. The scribes and the Pharisees hatched all sorts of plans to discredit the Lord Jesus. The Lord, however, did not mince words in exposing these religious leaders as empty traditionalists with only a ceremonial or outward shell of a religion. So our Lord unmasks them as hypocrites. For this reason, they hated the Lord Jesus with a passion and would not stop until He was discredited or destroyed. And things became even more dangerous for the Lord Jesus because the ruler of that area was Herod Antipas. He was a petty, paranoid king who was tasked to keep the peace in Galilee. Herod Antipas, like many petty kings, rulers, congressmen, senators, presidents, was mistrustful and insecure that someone might usurp his throne. Herod's paranoia even led to the execution of John the Baptist because the Lord's forerunner was calling the ruler out for his sin of adultery. But when news got to Herod about the miraculous works the Lord Jesus was doing and that many Jews were beginning to follow Him, he was even more afraid. Some even whispered to Herod that this popular miracle worker might be John the Baptist risen from the dead. And the crowds themselves did not help. They had witnessed great miracles and concluded that the Lord Jesus should lead a revolution to overthrow the hated Herodians and the dreaded Romans. But their concept of the Messiah who would deliver them was way off base. The burgeoning scenario, therefore, makes us understand why the Lord left Galilee and traveled to Tyre and Sidon, as we read in verse 21 of chapter 15. In our modern times, this would be leaving Palestine for the land of Lebanon to the north. But as we saw in our previous studies, the Lord Jesus also had another reason for leaving Galilee. He sought seclusion. He sought a release from the pressure. He understood that if these scenarios in Galilee were allowed to play out, it would thwart the ultimate design and plan of God for those he would save. Moreover, the Lord wanted a time of rest and prayer. He wanted time with his disciples too, so that he can further disciple and instruct them. But no sooner had he arrived in that Gentile territory than a Syrophoenician woman came to him pleading for mercy for her demonized daughter. And we read that in verses 21 to 28. And if you will recall, we tackled that before. Like I said earlier, this Gentile woman displayed great faith and humility. But what contrast we see here? On one hand is the resistance, rejection, hatred, hypocrisy, shallowness, and spiritual pride of the Jews in Galilee. And on the other hand is the genuine humility and faith of this Gentile woman. So, what the Lord could not find among his own, he found in this Gentile stranger, in this woman. Interestingly, in Matthew's narrative thus far, up to this point, we hear the Lord say, "You have great faith," only twice. And in both times, Jesus said those words to a Gentile, not to a Jew. Now, this picture of the Lord's mercy extended to this Gentile woman and that of the and the episodes recorded in our text today are significant. You see, by ministering and showing mercy to these Gentiles, the Lord Jesus is giving a prophetic picture of the extension of the kingdom. We must understand that the plan of God to send the Lord Jesus Christ to Israel was not the end goal, but the means of reaching the world. The divine plan of the triune God from the very beginning was to reach the entire world. Not just the nation of Israel, to reach the entire world with the message of salvation of Jesus Christ. And if you think about it, the Lord did and said many things that are a preview of the kingdom. For example, when the Lord Jesus was transfigured, he demonstrated his blazing second coming glory. But this was a small glimpse of the glory that he would display when he returns to set up his kingdom. When the Lord taught about the kingdom, he once again gave a preview of the kingdom when the knowledge of the Lord will fill the earth. Even his many miraculous healings give a preview of what will occur in the kingdom when he heals the nations. So this episode in our text today is a great preview of God's great plan through the Lord Jesus Christ that should be especially dear to us since we are not Jews. Now, I don't know if you notice it, but Matthew's description here in our opening verse, in verse 29, is rather nondescript or unremarkable. I mean, reading this verse, you would think that it's just one of those details that is so humdrum, so ordinary. You probably just passed it as you read the passage. He simply tells us that the Lord left Tyre and Sidon, where, as we know, he had met the Canaanite woman and had cast the demon out of her daughter. We are not even told by Matthew how long the Lord stayed in Tyre and Sidon and what else he did other than healing this daughter of this Canaanite woman. But Matthew tells us here that he is now somewhere along the Sea of Galilee, and he gives us that detail that he has gone up a mountain. Now, even if Matthew's report in this verse is rather lackluster, Charles Spurgeon, the prince of preachers in the 19th century, had an interesting comment. I quote, "How Jesus loved the mountains and the sea. By the Lake of Galilee, he again chooses a rising knoll, selects a standing place with ground around it for an assembly, and opens another session of his ministry of mercy. He sat down there, for he had set his head, he had set his heart upon blessing the people on that convenient spot. In imagination, we see him taking his seat and then speaking ex cathedra from the rising ground. The mountainside was free to all, and none could complain of trespass. And it was far enough from the busy towns to escape the noise of necessary labor. See how the people crowd. Our Lord's presence will not long be unnoticed, though no sound of church-going bell gave notice of a service. As a preacher, he never lacked a congregation. Where he sat down, the people came. If he went up into a mountain, they climbed after him." And then Spurgeon adds something that would encourage faithful preachers today. Continuing, he said, "If we preach Jesus in the most out-of-the-way village, in a region almost inaccessible, we shall not be left without hearers." End of quote. Of course, this does not mean that the thousands who flocked to the Lord Jesus sought him out for his preaching regarding the kingdom. I am convinced that the healings, more than anything, made a huge crush of people come around the Lord Jesus. But to be sure, there were those who listened to what the Lord taught. They may not have numbered in the thousands, but I believe that they received the Lord's pronouncement about the kingdom and turned away from their false gods and beliefs, just like the Syrophoenician woman did earlier. So I think Charles Spurgeon is correct in pointing this out in this verse. Preaching the Lord Jesus Christ is the priority of every minister of the gospel. God is not looking for preachers to be clever, but just be faithful to the text and preach the Lord Jesus Christ. The ministers who are to be faithful in fulfilling their ministry must never shrink back from announcing the truths of the scripture. They are to announce it, herald it, proclaim it, and then explain it, teach it, break it down, and make it clear. But sadly, too much modern preaching ignores the meaning of Scripture altogether. Many pulpits are filled with preachers who are unwilling to do the hard work necessary to interpret Scripture properly. They pad their messages with stories, anecdotes, and clever outlines, all of which disguise the weakness or lack of biblical content. In a recent pastor's convention, the CCM convention just this year, I taught from the text, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 to 5, calling pastors to fulfill their ministry. And at some point, I shared the story of the last 2 days of the great Presbyterian preacher, Charles Edward McCartney. his brother, Robertson, who was also a preacher, paid him a visit as he lay there dying. As it turned out, Robertson was on his way to preach at a nearby church. After the visit, and as Robertson turned to leave, the ailing great preacher gave one piece of reminder for his brother's preaching at that nearby church. He said, "Put all the Bible you can into it." Brethren, the contemporary church desperately needs to see this truth. Why? Because pragmatism is the guiding principle of many churches around us today. In fact, some of the largest and most influential churches now, right here in the Philippines, boast of Sunday services that are designed to be fun and entertaining than reverent. So, from their pulpits, traditional methodology, most notably expository preaching, is being discarded or downplayed in favor of newer methods such as comedy, variety, dance, sideshow histrionics, pop psychology, homespun tips for daily living, and other entertainment forms. These so-called new methods are supposedly more effective. That is, they draw a crowd. But as I have said often, pragmatism as a guiding philosophy of ministry is inherently flawed. When pragmatism becomes a guiding philosophy of life, theology, and ministry, or when it is used to make judgments about right and wrong, it will inevitably clash with Scripture, and it will never provide true solutions to the problem of sin or bring humanity a step closer to God. When a pastor rises at his pulpit, he must make his priority to put all the Bible he can into it. A pastor then must be a man of the word. He must study it, learn the genres, the themes, and outlines of all books. He must capture the main point of every passage he preaches from. He must memorize the great passages, immerse himself in the narratives. He must be founded on the great Bible doctrines, know the great examples of faith, discover God's heart in every text. And when a pastor puts all the Bible he can into his preaching, as Spurgeon said, we shall not be left without hearers. Hence, it does not matter if a pastor is not situated in a commercial district teeming with people, preach the gospel and the Lord Jesus Christ, and he will do the rest. I don't know if you're all regular attendees here. There may be some people who are just visiting. If you are visiting and you belong to a church that is pragmatic, if you belong to a church where the pastor pads his preaching, he doesn't exposit correctly, and he just pads his preachings with all of those anecdotes, those jokes, those homespun advice, I would advise you to go up to your pastor and tell him, "Pastor, put all the Bible you can into it." And if you have won him to do that, you have done the kingdom of God a great service. Now, while Matthew merely says that the Lord was somewhere along the Sea of Galilee and on a mountain, the Apostle Mark gives us a little bit more information, saying that Jesus was in the region called Decapolis. Mark chapter 7, verse 31. Decapolis means 10 cities. Deca is 10, and polis means city. But these cities were small. Decapolis is situated on the southeast edge of the Sea of Galilee. It is not far from the area known as Gadara, where the Lord delivered two demoniacs and sent the demons into the herd of swine, as you will recall. Decapolis was wedged in between two territories under Jewish domination. One was controlled by Philip the Tetrarch, and the other controlled by Herod Antipas. And in the middle was Decapolis. These 10 cities were not Jewish states and were not under the rule of Israel or any of its monarchs. They were free Greek states. In fact, these Gentile cities were authorized by the Romans to mint their own coins, run their own courts, and have even their own small armies. Archaeologists have searched around this area and have unearthed monuments dedicated to Zeus, Artemis, Athena, Hercules, Demeter, and Dionysius, and other Greek gods. So the people who lived in Decapolis were deeply into Greek pagan religions. And yet, the Lord Jesus chose that place to minister. But I must remind you that the Lord Jesus was not unknown in that place. We know this because back in Matthew chapter 4, when the Lord began His ministry by teaching and preaching and healing, we learn that the Lord's fame went as far as Syria. Matthew 4, verse 24. And then verse 25 of chapter 4 adds, a large crowd followed Him from Galilee and Decapolis and Jerusalem and Judea and far and from beyond the Jordan. So some folks in Decapolis had heard about the Lord Jesus. Jesus' teaching and healing ministry had reached their ears. Thus, when news got around that the Lord was in the area, people eagerly went to Him. And that desolate place on the mountain became temporarily the greatest hospital that there has ever been in the history of the world. They brought their huge crowds of sick people and laid them at Jesus' feet. He has the most effective healing ministry, more effective than the most notable hospitals in the entire world, whether in New York, Switzerland, Paris, London, Singapore, or any city of the world. This was the greatest hospital in history. Isn't it amazing how a scrubby little place on earth can be sanctified by the presence of God and by the working of God? Well, the Lord Jesus stood there, and we see the volume of miracles. Verse 30, and large crowds came to Him, bringing with them those who were lame, crippled, blind, mute, and many others. And they laid them down at His feet, and He healed them. 4,000 men, as we learn later in verse 38. But this number excludes women and children. So the number could have been, what, 8 or 9,000, maybe more. And the Lord's power there was lavish. His power was full and completely equal to the task. There was no disease or malady that the Lord was not able to cure. This goes on for 3 days, as we are told in verse 32. And the crowd never leaves. All day long, the Lord heals and surely teaches them the things pertaining to the kingdom. And the Lord was no less powerful after 3 days of healing than He was at the beginning. To be sure, He could have continued healing people for more than 3 days, and He still would have effected the same miracles. But why did it take 3 days to heal all these people? The text does not tell us why, but I think it was because the Lord Jesus wanted a personal encounter with them. He wanted to touch them, talk to them about their souls, explain the kingdom with a word for 3 years, the entire duration So he wanted to talk to them, explain to them what he meant by the kingdom, and he wanted also to explain who God is. Pray for them, each one of them. He wanted that personal encounter because that's how God is. Brethren, let us never forget that Jesus Christ is Almighty God in the flesh. To be sure, if he wanted to, he could have banished illness from Palestine with a word, even at the start of his ministry, for 3 years, the entire duration of his ministry on earth. And no one would even know why they were healed. They just suddenly were healed. And he could have done that. He could have banished illnesses from the entire world if he wanted to. But he did not choose to do that. It would seem that what the Lord Jesus wanted was a somewhat, quote-unquote, inefficient process where he is dealing with each individual sinner. And in this particular case, it took 3 days. Now look at the variety of the healings, the Lord's healings. The lame, the blind, the crippled, the mute, those with myasthenia gravis. Yeah, it says there. In my Bible, it says, those with myasthenia gravis and all sorts of illnesses. What a wreck sin has made of the human body, right? Think about that. In fact, there is not a bodily function, there is not a member of the human body, a part of the human body, not an organ, not a body part that is not somehow afflicted by disease, wrecked by sin. Physicians tell us that, will tell you that there is no part of the body that is left unscathed in the human body. There is none. You might ask, well, what about fingernails? Well, yes, there is. There are funguses that attack our fingernails and make them change color and they fall out. What about the eyelids? Is there a malady about the eyelids? Well, there is a parasite that causes a malady called trichiasis, which causes the eyelids to turn in, and then the eyelashes abrade the cornea of the eye. And what torture it must be to have all your eyelashes scrubbing the surface of your eyes every time you blink. The liver, the heart, the lungs, the bladder, the blood, the circulatory system, the very cells in your body are fair game. Everything has been attacked, not just by one disease, but by multiple diseases. What a varied wreck sin has done to the human body. But in this scene, depicted in our text, the Lord Jesus healed all the people's diseases without any diagnostic tools or processes. There is no CAT scan. There is no MRI. There is no X-ray. There is no blood test. There is no cultures being taken. By the way, if there is one lesson that I have learned from my health problems and my hospitalizations these past months, and you have to listen intently to this because this is from the Lord. The Lord really taught me. It's very important. And I'm sure all doctors will agree with me. Do not seek consultation about your health issues using Dr. Google. That's from God. Okay, I'm prove it in scripture. No, I'm just kidding. Google may be used only in defining certain illnesses and giving a general idea of how the illnesses are normally treated. But beyond that, Google cannot give you an accurate diagnosis of your problem much less provide the course of treatment for your malady. In fact, if you're dependent on Google to diagnose your condition, at the end of the day, you will feel like you're about to die. So don't consult with Dr. Google. Well, the Lord Jesus certainly did not consult Google. He just healed them perfectly. Now, perhaps some of you might be wondering, why don't those kinds of healing go on today? I am not standing here, I'm not sitting here saying there are no miracles today. I am not saying that there are no healings today. I am saying, why not this kind of ministry? Well, we need to understand that it is not God's purpose to banish illness from the face of the earth. All right? You see, the Lord Jesus' miracles and even that of his apostles were meant to be what they are called in the New Testament. That is, signs pointing to something. It's like when you are driving to a city and road signs tell you that you're like 150 kilometers to your destination. And for us believers, these miraculous healings by the Lord Jesus and even by his apostles are signs telling us where we are heading towards a kingdom where there will be no pain or death or mourning or crying, where God's sovereign power will banish it forever, where all believers will have a resurrection body that is not ravaged by sickness or disease in any way. Tragically, however, some preachers have taught and claimed that they have received a supernatural gift of healing in the same mold as the Lord and the apostles. People like the late Oral Roberts, Kenneth Copeland, Kenneth Hagin, Benny Hinn, etc. And of course, we have our local versions of these types of preachers. Let us be clear about this. The miracle working ministries of Christ and the apostles were unique. The healings that Christ and his apostles performed were supernaturally powerful, entirely successful, undeniable, immediate, spontaneous, and purposeful, serving as signs that authenticate the gospel. While the New Testament does not instruct believers, to pray for those who are sick and those who are suffering, trusting the great physician to do that which is according to his will, that is not equivalent to the supernatural gift of healing described in the New Testament. Clearly, there has been no parallel in history to the unique healing miracles that occurred at the time of Christ and the apostles. To be sure, the Lord still answers prayers and works in providential, and I would dare say sometimes even miraculous ways to heal people according to his will. So on that day and in that lonely place in the mountain, we are told in verse 31, so the crowd marveled as they saw the mute speaking, the crippled restored, and the lame walking, and the blind seeing, and they glorified the God of Israel. The word marveled is translated from thauma or thaumaso. It means to wonder, to marvel, and be struck with admiration and astonishment. This tells us that people first had a sense of astonishment, whether critical or inquisitive, then admiration with a tinge of awe and a fear of at what is unusual or what is mysterious. But seeing the healings that were going on en masse, they were struck with absolute awe at this scene. And so we read in verse 31, the second part, they glorified the God of Israel. Remember, these were Gentiles. They worshiped false gods. Incredibly, however, their wonder was greater than the wonder of the Jews. Like I said earlier, the wonder of the Jews was always limited by their shallowness, skepticism, pride, and their bondage to their ceremonies and traditions. But these Gentiles distinguish which God they are glorifying. And they recognize that all that Jesus had done was not done by their gods, but by the God, the Almighty God of Israel. But we learn that this was not all that the Lord did. We are not only told of the Lord's amazing power to heal all diseases, but Matthew highlights here the feeding of the multitudes. Let's read from verses 30 to 39. And Jesus called his disciples to him and said, I feel compassion for the people because they have remained with me now 3 days and have nothing to eat. And I do not want to send them away hungry, for they might faint on the way. The disciples said to him, where would we get so many loaves in this desolate place to satisfy such a large crowd? And Jesus said to them, how many loaves do you have? And they said, 7 and a few small fish. And he directed the people to sit down on the ground. And he took the 7 loaves and the fish, and giving thanks, he broke them and started giving them to the disciples. And the disciples gave them to the people. And they all ate and were satisfied. And they picked up what was left over of the broken pieces, 7 large baskets full. And those who ate were 4,000 men, besides women and children. And sending away the crowds, Jesus got into the boat and came to the region of Magadan. Let me go back to the question earlier. Why would Matthew include this story in his account of Jesus' life? Why did Jesus do this sort of miracle all over again? Why give us this sense of deja vu? Well, let me first tell you about a 14-year-old farm boy in Utah in the United States. This was in the year 1920. And this boy was plowing a field back and forth because he was a farm boy. He went over the furrows again and again. Every time he passed by the furrow, it got a little deeper. But this boy was also a genius whose hobby was electronics. His name was Philo Farnsworth. As he went back and forth in these furrows, he got an idea. And out of that idea came television. It works in the same way. Television works in the same way as plowing that field. Repetition. Endless repetition. The stream of electrons hits this phosphorus-coated glass. As soon as it hits it and it moves on, it starts to fade. Then the stream comes back and refreshes it and then starts to fade again. Now, let me ask you, are you like that? I mean, does the stream of God's word hit you and as soon as it moves on, it starts to fade, sometimes even quickly? I mean, are you the sort of person who, you come out of this place and then you're still at the elevator, ano nga bang topic natin today? My goodness, God, help us. I think nasa Acts tayo, Acts 15 yata tayo. Are you that sort of a person? It sometimes just fades so quickly. The truth is we can become forgetful, not faithful, but forgetful hearers of the word and also not doers of the word. We can read something in the scriptures, and as soon as we put the Bible down, it starts to fade quickly. And we need a refresher course. In fact, we need to be refreshed in the Word of God again and again. You know, during those days I spent in the hospital, I was actually thinking about this text. Hindi ako makatulog. Ano kaya to? I was able to sleep. But I was thinking about this text a number of days. I knew that this text was next in our study series. And I was wondering, why are there two feeding accounts placed so close to each other in Matthew's gospel? And as a teacher of God's word, trying to expose it properly, I asked myself, what am I going to do with the feeding of the 4,000 account here in Matthew 15 that I did not do with the feeding of the 5,000 which we already tackled in chapter 14? Well, the best sense I can make of why these feeding accounts were repeated so close to each other is because we need to learn again and again. This is how we are. We easily forget what we've learned, and we need constant refreshing. And as they say, repetition is the mother of all learning. Let me ask you, does yesterday's miracle necessarily guarantee today's faith for you? God did something for you yesterday, and you say, wow, the Lord answered my prayer. Does it guarantee that today you will have the same faith because God answered your prayer, even perhaps in a quote-unquote miraculous way? Does it guarantee today's faith? No, it does not. And this truth was exemplified by the apostles right here in this text. The Lord told his disciples, I feel compassion for the people because they have remained with me 3 days and have nothing to eat. And I do not want to send them away hungry, for they might faint on the way. To which the disciples replied, Where would we get so many loaves in this desolate place to satisfy such a large crowd? They reasoned that this was a desert place, a wild country with few inhabitants, and only a region containing large towns could, at short notice, furnish food for such a multitude. And this wild country was a good many miles from the nearest cities of Decapolis. The obvious answer to the disciples' question is, there is no place here and no human being on the entire planet who can provide food for a multitude in the wilderness. Only God can. But had the Lord's disciples forgotten about the feeding of the 5,000? Yes, they did. In fact, later, the Lord will remind them of both these demonstrations of power because they forgot about both miracles. Not just one miracle, but both. How do we know this? In Matthew 16, in the next chapter, the Lord is speaking here of the leaven of the Pharisees, which confused the disciples. So the Lord told them in Matthew 16, open your Bibles there, verses 9 to 10. Take note, it says, do you not yet understand or remember the 5 loaves of the 5,000 and how many baskets full you picked up? Or the 7 loaves of the 4,000 and how many large baskets full you picked up? Did you notice that important detail the Lord brings up here? He referred to both events as having really happened in history. And so, this really debunks the theory of liberal scholars. But take notice too that he reveals that the disciples failed to understand and remember the lesson of both miracles, miraculous feeding of the 5,000 and the 4,000. In other words, after Matthew 15, sometime later in Matthew 16, they forgot both miracles. They were prone to forget. Now the disciples asked the Lord Jesus where they can get enough bread, and he patiently answered them just like he did before with the feeding of the 5,000. How many loaves do you have? 7, they replied, and a few more small fish. Okay, Jesus said, let's have all the people sit down. And the disciples are definitely, at that point, they are definitely having a deja vu moment, right? They're saying, looks like this happened before. But we should not be too hard on the disciples here. Don't be too critical of them for forgetting the lessons behind the Lord's miracles. How many times has God provided for us in the past, and yet we still have trouble trusting Him for whatever we are going through in the present? The truth is, we all have the capacity and tendency to forget God's goodness and compassion. We have experienced God's kindness in the past, but we fail to draw the right conclusions from that kindness today. We have the tendency to forget who the Lord Jesus is and what He does for His children. This is where we see the importance of rhythms of repetition. And by this I mean the rhythms of life endlessly repeated. The book of Ecclesiastes illustrates this in nature. Open to Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verses 5 to 7. Notice what the writer said. The sun rises and the sun sets, and hastening to its place, it rises there again, blowing towards the south, then turning toward the north. The wind continues swirling along, and on its circular courses, the wind returns. All the rivers flow into the sea, yet the sea is not full. To the place where the rivers flow, there they flow again. Rhythms of repetition. Now we have the same thing in our everyday life, right? You have rituals for breakfast, correct? You have rituals for lunch. You have rituals for dinner and rituals in your own family. Somebody said, sow a thought, reap an action. Sow an action, reap a habit. Sow a habit and reap a character. Sow a character and you'll reap a destiny. So every day, you are taking a step towards developing a righteous character, or one that is unrighteous, by what you choose to do by repetition. We have these endlessly repeated rituals in life. And the Lord has taken this quote-unquote mechanism that He has built into the human personality, and He is using it for our good in sanctification. Take the songs we sing here in our corporate worship services. The melodies may be different, but the themes of the songs are repeated over and over, aren't they? And then as Christians, the Lord instructs us to observe the ordinance of the Lord's table, which we will do later on. And we do this over and over in remembrance of Him. Why? Because we tend to forget. We tend to suffer short-term memory loss. The most important repeated habit of the Christian life is Bible intake. This means taking the scripture in again and again so that you would be transformed by the renewing of your mind. I mean, you don't say, I've read the Bible, page from cover to cover. Give me another book. No, you read it over and over again. You would read the call of Abraham from Ur of the Chaldees, the sacrifice of Isaac on Mount Moriah, Jacob's ladder and the angels ascending, the birth of Moses and how he was placed in that basket made to float in the Nile River, then his call at the burning bush. You would read about the story of Christ's birth, the Immaculate Conception of Mary by the Holy Spirit, the Lord's birth in the manger because there was no room in the inn, the coming of the three magi from the east. All these are very familiar stories. You've read them before. But there is always something new to be learned. And in God's providence, we're always in a different place in our life when we come around to those stories again. And so we pick up something that speaks to our situation and help us, right? You've come across this passage before, but you just, you know, passed it by. But years later, you're in a particular situation in your life, and you come by that passage again, and it means different to you. The repetition was important. All this is done because God wants to teach us. God wants to allow us to take them in, to pick up something, even if we've gone over those passages before. We need to be refreshed in our minds and hearts. The fact is, repetition is essential in our spiritual lives. Some lessons have to be repeated endlessly until we learn them. By the way, that is also how we develop sinful habits. We commit a sin and do it again. And do it again. And then again. Until the sin becomes a habit we cannot break away from. But in the same manner, God intends to present our bodies to Him as servants of righteousness. The members of our bodies, again and again, day after day, to serve Him as patterns of righteousness, as Paul teaches us in Romans 6. We must be reminded again and again. We need to hear the same things again and again. And the Holy Spirit has been given us for that very purpose. It's one of His main ministries, the ministry of reminding. This was what the Lord taught in John 14, verse 26. He said, "But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in My name, He will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I said to you." The Apostle Paul had a strong ministry of reminding also. He said in Philippians 3, verse 1, "Finally, brethren, rejoice in the Lord." To write the same things again is no trouble to me, and it is a safeguard for you. What was he referring to when he said it is a safeguard for you? He's referring to the simple message like, rejoice in the Lord. But Paul is not done. In Philippians 4, verse 4, he says, rejoice in the Lord always. So his readers are saying now at this point, okay, Paul, we get it. It's twice now you said it. But he isn't done yet. He adds in the same verse, again, I will say rejoice. It's endless repetition. We need this. And the need is even greater with respect to the basic facts of the gospel. This is the reason for remembering Christ's passion during Holy Week. The focus is the death of Christ Jesus. And then we have Easter Sunday. We celebrate the resurrection in a special way because these patterns help us remember the basic facts about the gospel. Paul did the same for the Corinthian believers. We read in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 to 5. "Now I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you." Notice he said preached. He has done it before. "Which also you received, in which also you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. So notice he said, I already preached this to you. And then he repeats the gospel. Paul tells the Corinthians that they know these things already. It is not the first time that they're hearing the gospel. But why does he repeat the gospel? Because they and we too need to be reminded. Peter also had a ministry of reminding and repetition also. He wrote in 2 Peter 1 verse 12, therefore, I will always be ready to remind you of these things, even though you already know them and have been established in the truth which is present with you. So, just with the Lord's disciples, we need to be reminded of the things of God. Therefore, we need to refresh our memories with respect to Bible doctrine. We need to read through the Bible consistently. We need to memorize Scripture. The endless repetition of the verses we're memorizing helps us. It transforms our lives by renewing our minds. So we learn here that the disciples did not gain any insight from the incident of the feeding of the 5,000 in chapter 14. And they are still not sure about feeding the crowd here in Decapolis. In fact, they were just being realistic, you know, when they asked where they could get enough bread. But it is never realistic to discount the Lord Jesus. It is never rational, never practical to count Jesus out. The disciples made the mistake of forgetting the one who works miracles with just a crumb of power. So using the 7 loaves and few small fish, the Lord Jesus takes and blesses and he gives. He gave the food to the disciples so they could feed the crowd. The disciples were the distributors. And to whom were they giving out the food? To the Gentiles. You might say that they are now sitting the quote-unquote dogs at the table of their Lord to receive the children's bread, using the picture of the Syrophoenician woman earlier. I imagine that there was a hush and gasps of disbelief as the miracle unfolds. Laughter and excitement then bounce from group to group as the people see the food keep increasing. People wave their bread in the air. It's a miracle. But the disciples' minds go to a place in Jewish history none of their guests, the Gentile guests, would have known. They recall that Moses did this to their fathers in the wilderness. And so they wondered, could Jesus be giving manna to all mankind? Could Jesus be a greater Moses for the Gentiles no less? Much later, after the Lord had resurrected and ascended to heaven, they will have these questions answered. Interestingly, all 4 accounts of the feeding of the 5,000 use the word kophimos for the basket to gather the leftover food. A kophimos was a small wicker basket, big enough to hold provisions like a knapsack. But the feeding of the 5,000 account used the word sporidas. It was a large reed basket that was big enough to hold a man. In fact, this was what was used when people let Paul down from that Damascus wall in Acts chapter 9, verse 25. Sporidas, a large basket. So the Lord gave to the people liberally, in good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, as the Lord described in Luke 6:38, when he taught people how to give to others. Friends, let us not fail to see in this episode that the Lord Jesus is equal to God in all ways. This was revealed in His creative power. This was clear in His healing power. He not only cured all diseases, restored hearing and sight, and made the lame and crippled to walk. Moreover, we recognize Christ's equality to God, because only God could have multiplied those 7 loaves of bread and a few fish, even one-fold, much less many thousand-fold. And in the end, we underscore Christ Jesus' equality with God when the Gentiles worshiped Him. Friends, this is the goal of ministry. Although most, if not all of the multitudes in Decapolis were pagan Gentiles, they were astonished beyond measure when they witnessed the healing of the multitudes. Thus, they glorified the God of Israel. This was more than just having a sense of awe. It was reverential worship. And those Gentiles offered this as best as they could. As we have seen, the Lord had compassion to heal their broken bodies and feed their empty stomachs. But He was more concerned that they learn to trust Him as their Savior and Lord, which will save their souls from eternal damnation. So, brethren, as we close, do not forget to trust the Lord to provide for all your needs. Remember that God does not leave His people empty. If the power and compassion of the power of Christ, Jesus demonstrated in this episode, are not enough for you to counteract doubts within you, then I would like to remind you of Psalm 37, verses 23 to 25. The steps of a man are established by the Lord, and he delights in his way. When he falls, he will not be hurled headlong, because the Lord is the one who holds his hand. I have been young, and now I am old, yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, or his descendants begging bread. Of course, you might have to wait, like the crowd did, for 3 days. But whatever it is that you are waiting on Him in faith for, He will make it worth the wait. Let's pray. Dear God and Father, thank you, Lord, for once again reminding us of who you are. Thank you, Jesus, for displaying your great power, for assuring us, dear Lord, that you will never leave your people empty-handed. Thank you, dear God, that whatever it is that we need, as the psalmist said, you will not allow your descendants begging bread. We commit to you, each one. And even in this room, dear Lord, we have different needs. Some of us need provision for their sustenance, for their daily bills, and for the things that they need to purchase. Some of us here need healing. Some of us need inspiration. Some of us here may need a job. Some of us here may need encouragement. Whatever, dear Lord, it is that we need, you are the great provider. Your power knows no bounds. And so we entrust all our needs into your great hands. Thank you, Father, because you will never disappoint your people. We commit to you, each one, even as we open this new week, and trust you for the faith today, even as you've proven your faithfulness yesterday. We give you praise and thanks, O God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's rise for our song of worship.
The misery that was hidden for ages and generations knowledge of eternal life that came to dwell inside of you. It is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christ in you, the hope of things to come.
Of your grace in our midst today. You have refreshed our souls indeed, Lord. We bless your name. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.